Okay. So I understood that I have half an hour plus whatever time I take extra.
The other half an hour comes from this side of the room.
Okay, it's a pleasure to be back here. I'll talk about some continuation of work I've been doing over the last 1.5 year, 2 years, studying sort of the basic type of questions that we've been struggling with in the context of holographic reconstructions of space-time, interiors of black holes, or just even just the bulk of AdS space-times. And many of those questions are of a sort of sufficiently sort of generic type that even in lower dimensional examples, there's a rather still the same set of questions around. In particular, in 2 plus 1 AdS space, there are black hole space-times, which we know as BTZ black holes, and all the information theoretic puzzles that we are struggling with are just as clearly present over there. But there's a specific aspect of AdS CFT duality in three dimensions that makes it much more accessible to computation. And one of the reasons is the following, is that if you go to conformal field theories with large central charge, which is really means that that's the weakly coupled limit of the bulk theory, then there are going to be certain quantities at large central charge which are universal to CFTs and quite to all CFTs with large central charge. And in particular, if you know that the CFT would have some kind of weakly coupled gravity dual, then you expect certain universal properties of all the CFTs, and those can actually also be kind of uncovered just by thinking about the CFT itself. One example is the Cardi formula, the Cardi growth of states. There's derivations of Ryutaginiti, basically, based on the conformal anomaly in two dimensions.
But the Cardi formula doesn't require large central charge.
It doesn't require large central charge, but things do get more robust in that regime of large conformal dimension, large central charge. And even things like the conformal bootstrap should have universal features in that regime, which would then be related to the geometric reconstruction of a bulk, maybe, but also conformal blocks. Essentially, at large central charge, we know quite a bit about conformal blocks. Basically, what conformal blocks are, they're basically evaluating the Liouville action or on a corresponding constant curvature metric in two dimensions.
So when you say things that are universal large central charge, should I assume that you're also using a sparse spectrum assumption, or do you mean truly universal for all large central charges?
No, I mean, indeed, I use this sparse spectrum assumption, indeed, with the implicit assumption that this is a theory that in certain regimes is dominated by gravity in the bulk. Okay. And so the bulk insight is indeed useful. But the kind of structures that you get are also sort of independently can be argued for from the point of view of the CFT. So we had a paper a little while back about using this kind of philosophy to study scattering in a 2 plus 1 gravity. And indeed, one can get very quantitative formulas about scattering amplitudes in the gravitational sector just by using the conformal bootstrap with the same kind of philosophy. But let me, for today, focus on a separate idea, a separate sort of output of this kind of philosophy, which is simply to ask the question, which indeed many people have been thinking about for a longer time, but more recently in the context of bulk reconstruction. If you take an AdS space-time, and let's, for the sake of any sort of relevance to questions people have been thinking about here, think about it as an AdS space-time with a black hole background. And for simplicity, let me draw it as an eternal black hole. Then, again, in AdS 3, this would then be the BTZ black hole. And again, many of the puzzles that we're struggling with is the fact that we don't really know exactly how, from the point of view of the bulk, we should be thinking about our Hilbert space that lives on the spatial section. And again, there were having many talks about this at this workshop. A specific question one could ask is, indeed, if you have a local point here, And let me use the following notation. X is a point in ADS 3. I have a radial direction, which I generically, for now, denote by Y. And I have two spatial directions. This thing here, sometimes I'll just abbreviate with X, maybe. The Z and Z bar. So this is a three-dimensional coordinate. And I could imagine having... Sorry?
Is Euclidean?
I start with Euclidean, but indeed... later on, I'll go to Minkowski, and then I replace Z and Z bar by indeed the U and the B. But let's ask the question, okay, what does the local bulk field look like if I place it at a point in the bulk? And this is already a bit of a funny question to ask to some extent, and again, many people have made progress in understanding these operators in the bulk. But there's a bit of tension, of course, between what AdS CFT really represents and this question of finding a local field in the bulk. Because to some extent, what the CFT does, it gives you answers to what you would maybe want to call to on-shell questions, where you integrate out the bulk with certain boundary conditions at infinity. And then those correlation functions that you get at the boundary, it's sort of the equivalent of an S matrix quantities are then the CFT quantities. And in some sense, it seems as if we're kind of looking at this as an on-shell system, whereas being able to create an object just right from a situation where, say, a particle doesn't exist, and then this phi field introduces a particle in the bulk, that's definitely a different kind of notion than typically the ones that we can study by just sitting at the boundary. But nonetheless, such an operator should exist in the CFT because we essentially have the identification, and maybe I should still put a question mark here, but it's sort of the philosophy that goes behind AdS CFT, is that the Hilbert space of the bulk theory should really be equal to the Hilbert space of the CFT. So let this indeed be our working assumption. And then it means indeed that bulk operators, which can change the state in the Hilbert space of the bulk, should be embedded into operators of the CFT. Now, if this has a weakly coupled dual, then I could take this thing to be some field with a certain mass, a low energy field in the effective field theory in the bulk. And again, I'm going to work at large central charge so that the bulk is weakly coupled. And in that regime, also the interactions in the bulk should be suppressed. And to leading order, perhaps you can even think about these things as free field in the bulk. And the question is, what is this bulk operator? Now, if I have some local field in the CFT, so it is an operator in the CFT, that's the correspondence that we would like to make, is that this thing is the related to one of these local operators in the bulk through a simple kind of boundary condition that if the bulk field approaches the boundary, then up to some scale factor, which maybe I'll put here, this should then be the boundary field. So this is a boundary condition of what we want to, how we want to glue the bulk to the boundary. And then at large C, there is some wave equation that this thing should satisfy. in the bulk. And this, in some ways, uniquely specified some kind of field in the bulk, because again, once I know the boundary values and I know the equation of motion in the bulk, I can use some kind of Green's function or some smearing function to write this phi field indeed in terms of the O field. And let me be a little bit schematic here, although I guess there could be some Green's function or smearing function, it's usually called nowadays, that relates these two things. Let me put again a question mark here, because I want to criticize this formula for where a bit, because again, this k here is a C number. It's just a thing that satisfies this equation in the bulk with some appropriate boundary conditions at infinity, using Green's theorem essentially. And but this wave operator here, for example, depends on the specific background that we have here, and therefore this thing is background dependent. It explicitly makes use of the fact that there should be AdS CFT, so it explicitly makes use of a bulk geometry. And I would not call this particular thing an intrinsic definition of a bulk operator. And thirdly, turns out that there are some issues indeed if you look at higher angular momentum modes that this prescription runs into trouble.
But in this way, it implies kind of Minkowski space, right? When you are speaking about this mass spectrum.
That's right. So one thing which indeed I'll be more explicit about in a second is that often, as one is often doing when you want to define a local operator, even in a Lorentzian theory, what you do is you take a local patch around the location of the operator. You often go to Euclidean space locally. Mm-hmm. Then you have some boundary condition on your path integral at a point in Euclidean space, and then you analytically continue back to Minkowski space to get your local operator in a Lorentzian signature. So that's the prescription that is implied here, and that's indeed the prescription that I'm going to implicitly assume throughout my talk. So, but it's true that, for example, this smearing function, what it does, it kind of propagates from the boundary into the bulk, which is sort of like a Euclidean propagation direction going in the radial direction into the bulk. And that leads to funny ambiguities, actually, even in that particular formula, which people like Daniel and company have emphasized. So, again, here in this case, what I don't like about the formula is that it makes explicit use of the classical bulk geometry, whereas I'd like to do something intrinsically in the CFT without referring to the bulk, and I'll just write down an operator that the CFT likes, and then see if it actually satisfies this equation, and then I'm sort of starting to reconstruct the bulk. So that's the idea. And so I'll immediately state the proposal, and then I'm going to check it. I could explain a bit more the motivation behind the proposal, but I'll probably do that during the discussion session of how I actually stumbled upon this proposal. But the formulation is actually so simple and direct that it's actually useful to just state it right from the back. So there are natural states in a conformal field theory, which are known as Ishibashi boundary states. These are not local states in the sense that they are non-normalizable in principle, at least to start out with. And the idea is that what you do is you give yourself a primary field, the thing that's created by that operator. It's a primary state in the Hilbert space. And then you basically write some kind of combination of descendants of this operator, but with a special condition that there's some state that looks like this, that satisfies a reparametrization invariance condition, which now is actually written often like this. And since this thing is made out of the Fiorizzoro descendants, basically you can write down a recursion relation that imposes this boundary condition, and there's a unique state that makes it.
This is special to 2D boundaries.
It's special to 2D boundaries, although you can think about this as essentially some kind of condition of reparametrization invariance along the curve that this thing is introducing, because this is essentially is a reflecting boundary condition. Because the way this thing looks like this condition, because it relates left and right descendants, if I have a generic notation that this is being a descendant for the left, and that's a descendant for the right, then very roughly this thing will look like this. Again, these are descendants in this sector prescribed by this conformal weight H.
What do you think would be the natural analog for higher dimensional CFTs?
Again, something probably for the discussion, because obviously, right, if this proposal indeed, and I'll show it works in CFT2, mm-hmm. what does it imply for higher dimension is an important question. But in any case, so once you have a state like this, this thing by itself is not a normalizable state. But it creates basically a boundary condition, at a reflecting boundary condition, where a left moving comes in and a right moving sort of comes out. But now I can take the following definition of my bulk operator, where I take that Ishibashi state and let me center this around . So this is the idea of radial quantization. I could take an origin and first represent this state as radial quantization around a given origin. And then if I move that origin to some other point, then I call that location Z and Z bar. And the operator, the bulk operator phi at location, bulk location Y, Z, Z bar, is simply given by when I act on it on the vacuum of the CFT, I get this propagated Ishibashi state.
So in terms of the logic, the Ishibashi constraint basically says you're invariant into spatial reparameterizations
right. At
a particular time. The form of the constraint is not preserved in time.
That's right.
Because and similarly here, so it's not clear why you should have a special time in some sense in the condition.
So what this thing means is the following. So again, as I said, there's a bunch of steps in between. So I want to define an operator at a given time in the Lorentzian theory. Okay.
It's
so
a state at a time. This is a state at a time, which means it's an op. Yeah.
No, let me say more clearly what I'm doing.
Yeah.
I want to define an operator. So you give me a CFT state, and I want to act with this operator at a given time. Okay. The way I do that is I represent the time evolution of the state, maybe by some path integral. And then I go and look at the region of the boundary theory of the CFT mm-hmm. around the location where I want to insert the operator. I go to Euclidean space. Mm-hmm. Again, I do the thing that I was just describing, that if you want to define an operator, I go to Euclidean space. I choose an origin of my Euclidean coordinate system mm-hmm. at the location where I want to pick the operator. I do radial quantization with that origin. So what that means is that if I want to put the operator here in the Euclidean path integral, I'm going to take a radial time evolution away from that point.
Yes.
So the special time at which this reparametrization invariance holds is a radial distance away from that.
Away
from the point at which I want to.
Yes. But what you're doing really is that you're actually removing a small hole from the Euclidean space, and you're imposing the conformal boundary condition on that boundary.
Right. Yes. So that's correct. So once you have this state, what it actually represents is a hole.
But if I would look at those H state, like say, depends on time, right? It's like a combination of different energies, right? So
right,
this way, it's not, I mean,
this L naught here is not the Hamiltonian that makes time run. So this indeed, I get now going to back analytically continue to U and V being some light Minkowski coordinates. And then the time evolution is actually the thing that moves this point up, whereas the L naught and the L naught bar that sits there are things that dilate.
Z and Z bar are coordinates on the plane, the sphere, the cylinder.
Locally, at least for now, it's local. I use local coordinates, where Z and Z bar are the coordinates indeed on the boundary of the CFT. These are the CFT coordinates.
Fair when you say.
But when I try to make this map, what piece of ADS am I supposed to be reproducing, or what?
Let's talk about that later, but for now I'm giving you this local, and I would call intrinsic definition of how I'm going to define an operator. And then later I have to map this operator, or at least I have to test how this operator acts on a particular set of states.
You just told me how it acts on the vacuum.
Right.
Yeah, but here it is only action on this kind of vacuum state. Right? In principle, you should define action on any state.
Right? That's right. I'll consider. But here I'm using the operator state correspondence, that if I tell you how it acts on the vacuum, so I tell you which state this operator creates.
If he's telling you how to stick it.
If I know which states it creates, I can use that state to insert at any point in my boundary space, and then I've defined for you what the operator is.
But it's going to insert a whole tower of states, that's the
point. Right. It will give you a whole tower of local states, local operators. This, by the way, is a normalizable state, but indeed, I guess I have a whole infinite tower of local descendants of the primary field, and that's going to be my block fit. Yes.
So you only use the fact that you have asymptotic ADS. Because how far can I extend y into the bulk?
Right. Here I've defined it, and let's now just see how it's going to work, because there's the following ambiguity, which indeed will come and play a role a little bit later on, is that I've chosen a particular coordinate system here, by which I define this state here, and strictly speaking, this operator indeed, since it creates a hole. It implicitly relies on a particular choice of my local coordinate system. If I do a conformal transformation that arbitrarily changes that coordinate z, I'm going to change the shape of this hole. Mm-hmm. So my operators don't, although I'm making it seem as if it only depends on three variables, it actually depends on the shape of a loop.
So why does the hole depend on a particular primary operator?
Because I want to create a bulk field whose mass is related.
No, I know that's why you wanted to, but just from a CFT point of view.
It depends on the boundary conditions that you put on the whole.
But you do somehow know that boundary conditions are in one-to-one correspondence with operators?
Yes.
Well, for certain theories, yeah.
But so far, these Ishibashi states can be defined for any dual CFT.
Yeah, although at least they've been most well understood for any rational theories. But given that this thing is sort of algebraically defined in terms of a power of a series of descendant states, I can solve these equations, and I can write down for you what this state is.
Is the idea somehow that the large C will allow us to push Y to deeper and deeper? I don't understand.
Large C is not a role, a pleasant play. By the way, I should say that although this is true at large C, my definition I propose is true for any C. So if you want to know about one of the C corrections, you're going to compute it from that definition.
But then, you see, I might as well take a CFT that I know doesn't have a bulk dual and study these states, and all of a sudden I'm talking about bulk duals that are not there.
No, you don't quantum gravity.
Sorry?
You don't quantum gravity.
Right, but somehow that should manifest itself in Y not being very large or.
So it's true that if that state does not satisfy this equation, but there are right-hand sides to this equation that become of order 1, then this equation starts losing its meaning. And then you could say that the bulk starts losing its meaning. So this thing is true at large C. And there's a certain sense in which you can compute one over C corrections.
But what's the CFT? How do we see this from the CFT point of view?
This.
That only. OK.
I'll, that's what the rest of my talk is.
OK, good.
Is this operator satisfy locality in the bulk?
Discussion session.
OK.
Actually, the discussion is supposed to be mixed in.
Right, but I think I should first explain where this equation is.
Doesn't suggest say that's a part three question.
That's for this afternoon, the session.
Let's say I'm looking at this equation, and that, is it possible that I would use this phi m in terms of y and x dependence as a plane wave, for example?
Right. So this is exactly what I want. I want to show that this thing naturally satisfies these equations.
Mm-hmm. I see.
Okay. Let me try to. Yeah.
I have a definition question I'm allowed to ask. So.
Good.
You're cutting out a hole. Don't you, in this definition, don't you also have to tell us the radius of the hole that you're cutting out? I don't quite get the definition.
Yeah. Okay. So now the definition. So I would say if the hole, when y is equal to 1, has radius 1 in the coordinate system. So y is the radius of the hole. So because if it starts out at radius 1, this thing rescales it. And so therefore, indeed, if y goes to 0...
If you look at the state on the boundary of the hole, it's not normalizable, but if you look at it...
If y equals 1, it's not normalizable. This state is not normalizable. This thing is normalizable.
Oh, I see.
And then in the y to 0 limit, obviously I'm going to satisfy this equation. Because in the y to 0 limit, the only thing that survives is actually...
It's the
primary state. So I've built in already this thing here.
I see. Okay.
Okay. So suppose I'm going to act with this operator on a given primary state, let me do the following. Let me look at a matrix element where. I do the following. This is right mover, left mover, conformal dimension. I have this operator. Oh, I forgot. I actually jumped over one thing here. Let me make one comment still. I think it's useful. If I write down an equation for a circle centered around a point, I can write it like this, c minus z0, z bar minus z0 bar equals y squared. That's an equation for a circle centered around z0 and y0, z bar 0. Okay. And I can write this equation actually with some appropriate identifications of the numbers a, b, and c in the following form that z is minus AC bar plus B divided by C Z bar plus D. So there is some SL2R group element that I can associate with that boundary. Okay. So sometimes actually I'll write down this thing like that, where this G is parameterizing that SL2R transformation.
Herman, another question on the definition, so I can the point y equals 1, where the state becomes non-normalizable again, what does this mean, at least at large C, in terms of the bulk?
Discussion question.
because this seems to be in the, this is independent
in the
of
discussion.
The
discussion. Already.
Yeah, no, but
half an hour has
no, no, but I can see a progression of sorry, harder questions. This is a hard question. Right now, I want to define this operator for small values of y, where clearly I'm looking at something that looks close to a local operator, and I just want to show that it satisfies this equation. And then we can talk about all the things that happen when y is equal to 1. Actually, y will actually almost start dropping out of the discussion soon, because it will be replaced by an eta coordinate that we're going to be identifying more clearly with the BTZ coordinate. Because it turns out that this prescription actually works even better for excited states than for ground states. At least the whole point is going to be that I can do this thing for arbitrary. I have take that definition, doesn't depend on any conformal dimensions, but I take the matrix element. Between these things are going to be states that have some large conformal dimension. So this is very large, large compared to C over 12, say. And I want to think about that state, indeed, as something that represents a black hole with a certain mass. Okay. And this thing will have roughly the same conformal dimension, but this thing could represent something with a little bit different energy. So H3 is, say, delta over 2 plus some energy, I think something like this. And this is angular momentum, and H4 is delta over 2 plus energy minus angular momentum. So this is just a way of starting to think about the action of this operator in a non-trivial background created by some heavy CFT operator. Now, if I use AdS CFT, I know what I want this thing to be. Again, it's a matrix element where I start out indeed with a black hole with a certain mass. That mass is essentially equal to this conformal dimension delta. Maybe there's a minus C over 12 again here somewhere. And is that correct? And the final state, again, if I would act with this operator, will be a black hole with a mass with a slightly different energy and with some angular momentum. But what I should expect is that if I compute that matrix element, that matrix element indeed solves the wave equation in the BTC black hole background with that mass parameter. So that's the thing that I would like to show. And okay, some comments. Let me indeed now start thinking about things in the semi-classical regime. And the first question is, where does BTZ come from? So the CFT BTZ correspondence is actually pretty well understood from the following perspective, is that if I take this matrix element, one thing I could do is I can look at the expectation value of the stress energy tensor. And in order to abbreviate my notation a little bit, this expectation value now is defined relative to this, say, internal state. Then one thing one can naturally do is one can always find some kind of other coordinate system, which I'll denote by big Z. And let me try to be clear about what's big and what's small. Such that, again, this is called the Schwarzschild derivative. Due to the conformal anomaly, it's possible to take the expectation value in some given state and find a coordinate system such that the expectation value can be written like that. What that means is that if I would go to the coordinate system Z, because of the anomalous transformation property of the stress energy tensor, there's a coordinate system in which the expectation value of the stress energy tensor is equal to zero. This is known, again, as you could call it a uniformizing coordinate system. Let me give you an example that if T of Z is some conformal dimension over Z squared, then it turns out that the coordinate transformation that you need, this coordinate z, let me write down the formula here, is little z to the power I times r plus, where r plus is the square root of 24 delta over c minus 1. And this happens to be equal to 8 g newton times m in the bulk. So this is r plus is actually the location of the BTC black hole horizon. But in this case, I've defined it in terms of a prescription in the CFT, where if I take the expectation value of a certain tensor, I can transform it away by going to this coordinate system. Okay. Now, this coordinate transformation is a little bit funny. It's multi-value. Because indeed, if z goes to e to the 2 pi I z, little z, then this thing undergoes a non-trivial monotomy. It turns out that that monotomy, and that maybe I'm not going to write down even the equations, the monotomy is precisely the S to R transformation that defines the B to Z geometry. So the B to Z black hole geometry is a quotient of S to R, and that quotient I can get out of a CFT correlation function by this prescription of looking for the coordinate system in which the Cezanity tensor vanishes. Okay. So so we already kind of see a B to Z monotomy appearing, and indeed, if I now start thinking about this phi of H as something whose argument is actually an SL2R transformation, I can already see that this phi H of G essentially lives on the BTZ geometry. So that's just a geometric derivation of already some BTZ structure. A couple of other comments. So I indicated that this thing here actually depends on the shape of a circle. However, if I already have specified an initial and a final primary state, then what I'm really looking at is, say, the initial state sits here, this thing sits here, that thing sits there. And then I have a hole. So as a complex structure, or at least as a two-dimensional Riemann surface with a hole and two punctures, I can count how many parameters, how many moduli that thing has. Has actually only one modulus, because three punctures on a sphere has no modulus. Two punctures on a disk has one modulus. And I'm going to identify that modulus, in this case actually with the radial coordinate here. But in general, indeed, if I add a hole to a Riemann surface, the Euler character goes down by one, and the number of moduli of the Riemann surface goes up by three. So indeed, a hole naturally has three coordinates, and those three coordinates are the location of the operator in the box. So now comes the more microscopic piece of evidence that I can compute this quantity. I can tell you how to compute it in the large C limit. And the answer from the point of view of the CFT looks as follows. I'll tell you what rho is, but rho is roughly it's this real modulus. It's related to y. It's related actually to the real part of z bar. So basically, this coordinate z. Oh no, okay. I'll tell you later what rho is. I'm jumping ahead. But if rho indeed is this radial distance here. And I'm going to define it in terms of BTZ coordinates like that relation, then it turns out that the bulk mode looks like this, and I claim that the CFT amplitude indeed also looks like this. Sorry. So this is a complicated expression. This is some hypergeometric function. And if you take the bulk equation of motion, which I just erased in a BTZ black hole background, then it turns out that if you specify the angular momentum and the energy that the mode has, so for given omega angular momentum and energy, this mode is given by that expression. Okay. Now, how would the CFT reproduce such a complicated expression? The way it does that is by a usual trick by which we can compute the expectation value of a quantity like this. Because basically what we're doing here is we're taking indeed a sphere at the south pole, we insert this state. At the north pole, we insert that state. And we have this circle, which we have a reflecting boundary condition. Let me draw the north pole and the south pole as the far early time and the far late time on a cylinder. And then I have this hole, and let me draw the hole like that. And that thing has a reflecting boundary condition. So this is the amplitude that we should compute with a given initial conformal dimension, given final conformal dimension, and given channel for the operator phi h that acts here and creates a hole. This expectation value, the usual way you do this, again, following John's way of thinking about boundary state, you go to a double. You basically just double the space. And indeed, modes now simply live on the double. But then you identify, at least you make it, take an orbifold of this spacetime by identifying the point here. Well, not an orbifold, but yeah, basically a point there. So you have a Z2 identification on this thing that's called the Schottky double. But the Schottky double doesn't have a boundary anymore. The way the boundary comes about is by requiring that the correlation function should be symmetric under that interchange, or that the geometry should be symmetric under that interchange. So you put the same weights here as you put on the left. And essentially, you take the square root out of this expression, and the square root out of that expression is the thing that we should be computing.
What happened to the label H?
The label H now sits here in the intermediate channel.
But does what? If it's just a, if those are just a smooth gluing, what's some role for H to play?
Okay, let's draw this thing differently.
Oh, you only sum over states in that conformal block.
Yeah. So we'll draw it differently.
Here's the conformal block.
Right. So the intermediate channel in the conformal block is specified to be H.
Herman, this only is satisfying the linear equation.
We're not quite there yet, but let's get there.
All right.
Let me make a few comments here, indeed. Since
did you tell us what rho was? I'm sorry.
I can tell you a little more about what rho is. So from the point of view of the bulk, so here, the game I'm playing here is I've written down an answer which I can motivate from the point of view of the CFT, which I'm about to motivate from the point of view of the CFT. But this is also the answer that will relate to this wave equation. And the wave equation is done in a particular coordinate system that indeed knows about the bulk geometry, and it knows about the position of the horizon in this by this definition of the coordinate rho. Although, actually, if you look at this expression here, in a somewhat funny way, the conformal dimension that determines the mass of the black hole sits in a rather almost hidden place. The only place where it sits is here. That's where the radius of the black hole sits.
You haven't really written an equation because the left-hand side is expressed in y and z bar, and right-hand
right.
side.
No, so I'll tell you how this comes about. So this thing here is a conformal block, and it has a cross ratio. and it must have a real cross ratio because it has this Z2 identification. And this rho is a parameterization of the real cross ratio of this four-point connection. So here it's a bit more manifest that indeed there's one real quantity that I'm looking at. And to be a bit more precise, is that what I need to do is I need to use the Z coordinate system and then rho is the same. So in the Z coordinate system, because there's, so Z is now
capital Z,
but it's the cross ratio in the coordinate system capital Z. The cross ratio of this quantity in the coordinate system of capital Z.
Why is Z equal to Z coordinate?
Because of the reality condition that you get by requiring that the.
But on the left-hand side of the equation, why is Z equal to Z coordinate?
Well, it's not. They're different Z's. That's little Z on the left.
Yeah, I see. Okay.
I still don't understand.
With your phi h of y, that's little
that's right.
Sorry, but rho should be a function of y, z, and z bar.
So let me tell you a little bit more about why this is the conformal block. And then it will become clear what rho is.
Okay. I think there's a spherical harmonic or something in there that you didn't write, which has to do with the other coordinates, right?
You're right. I separated out some e to the I omega c and e to the I L phi. Yeah.
So that gives you some dependence on the other coordinates.
Okay.
Clarify.
Yeah.
No, I actually did mention it. That indeed I was going indeed only to this.
That means you'll be rotated things so that it's only a function of one coordinate, right?
Right. So rho is indeed the radial coordinate, and the phi dependence has been fixed in this case because the phi and the t dependence have been fixed because I fixed the conformal dimensions. So, so this is a mode function in. The BTZ black hole background. But I claim it's also the conformal block. And one place where you can convince yourself that it's the conformal, at least that it comes from studying conformal blocks, is by looking at papers by it's some equation, and I should have written down the number, in an old paper by Ponceau and Teschner, where they study. They actually saw essentially the modular properties of Virasoro conformal blocks. And what they do is they indeed study not literally conformal blocks as having to do with gluing together three-point functions of Virasoro conformal field theory, but they recognize that the underlying structure is that of a quantum group, and that quantum group happens to be UQ as L2. And that quantum group indeed can be thought of as essentially the space of transformations that acts like that, but on this particular coordinate system Z. So if you give yourself a CFT, you go to that coordinate system and you study these transformations. Those transformations span a group, and that group actually has quantum corrections. And the reason is that constructing this uniformizing map only works in the limit for C to infinity, because this equation does not have a classical solution if C is finite.
So what's Q?
Q. Here is e to the I pi b squared
where C is 1 plus B plus 1 over B.
Square root of 6.
Yes. Okay, so that's the relation between the Q and the C. So indeed, in the limit where B goes to 0, where Q goes to 1, C goes to infinity. So if I work in that limit, then this just becomes SL2. But there's a formula in Poisson and Teschner where they indeed construct basically this object by gluing together two Clebsch-Gordan coefficients of this symmetry group. And they express it in terms of a hypergeometric function. And what they do is they have some funny hypergeometric function, which they call phi sub b, which is a quantum deformation of this hypergeometric function. And they write it down in terms of the Liouville momenta, rather than in terms of the conformal dimensions. They write it down in terms of the corresponding Liouville momentum. And then the equation looks like this. Yeah, they have some variable they call x. X turns out to be essentially related to this coordinate z, where the relation between the conformal dimension and the Liouville momentum is this relation. So instead of writing it in terms of conformal dimension, if you do this transformation, where alpha 1, 2 indeed is basically the difference between, sorry, maybe I should have called it 3, 1 here in my notation, and this 4, 2. So this number here is the difference in conformal dimension between 3 and 1. This number here is the difference in conformal dimension between 4 and 2. But if you indeed take their formula in terms of Liouville momenta and you translate it back through this formula as a statement in terms of conformal dimensions, you indeed exactly get this formula here. So the appearance of these quantities here indeed has to do with that transformation. There's another interesting paper recently by Fitzpatrick and company, who indeed argue that if you go to this particular coordinate system in general, that Virasoro conformal blocks actually look like global conformal blocks. Meaning the conformal blocks that you would write down by only looking at the, what do you call them, the quasi-primary decomposition.
SL2 descendants.
And those conformal blocks indeed are known. And they're given by hypergeometric functions, where indeed this quantity is not there. So basically, the global conformal blocks don't have those things sitting there. However, they say, well, that's only a true fact if you use this coordinate system. And the way they argue in favor of this in at large central charge is that if you factorize a correlation function at large central charge, then the higher descendants, which are not SL2R transcendents, have contributions that are suppressed by 1 over C, and therefore, at large central charge, you only need to worry about the SL2 descendants. However, because of this coordinate transformation here, again, maybe there's actually a 2 here, the eigenvalue of the L0 operator in this coordinate system is rescaled, again, by this factor in the other ones. So they have a similar formula like this for other conformal blocks. So basically, the conjecture or the proposal is that this is a formula for semi-classical conformal blocks in two dimensions. And it also supports the identification that this thing solves the wave equation in the block.
Is it supposed to hold for all large delta conformal blocks or just sort of generic ones at large delta? I'm worried about bulk spacetimes that correspond to BTZ with lumps of matter falling in that are not exactly BTZ.
Let me make a couple of comments. So what's the regime? I would say this thing should be, these conformal dimensions should be close to that.
right? Because otherwise my uniformizing coordinate system will become more complicated.
And close means the differences are small compared
small
to C.
Small compared to C. So these are large conformal dimension operators that are close to each other. This thing should be some light field. Mm-hmm. And in that regime, the point is that this thing here by now is completely specified by the Virasoro word identities because it's a complete conformal block. There are no unspecified channels.
But in that regime, the bulk geometry doesn't have to be BTZ. It could be BTZ with a star falling in.
In my regime, it cannot because the stars and four are close to this.
But the star could be in both states. So the differences are still small compared to C.
If this thing is a given conformal weight, conformal primary field, so this is a conformal primary field.
Yeah.
I've derived for you now in this case, in some ways, that the corresponding geometry is that of just a single BTZ geometry. The argument is basically this argument. So there's only one place where the pole sits, and that's the place where the black hole sits.
Does the star have definite angular momentum?
I could choose it.
Frequency.
So what you would be considering would be say, okay, well, there's something else coming falling in here, which means that I have to write down another state here, which is some complicated descendant of the primary field. That's the sum of the two energies.
I don't understand why it's a descendant. I don't understand why this can't be a primary as well.
Because the primary is precisely the thing that was only one single object that was created a very long time ago. Basically, the primary states are defined in past infinity, and if you throw in a star in past infinity, I don't care. So that's
it. Excuse me. If you want to consider just global ADS3, how can you
do this? How can I apply this thing to global?
You're using large C and delta is larger than C.
Right. So it's not entirely clear if I can smoothly take this correspondence and put the mass of the BTZ in my hole equal to zero. Actually, that's not a smooth limit. So to be completely honest, indeed, I have less understanding about how this prescription works in pure ADS space than in this case.
If it was a bulk to bulk two-point function, it's kind of a two-Ishibashi state.
Right.
Some over a four boundary.
Right. And in that case, so anyway, we should talk about this more. But indeed, the follow-up discussions are simply, okay, well, what happens if you start doing two-point functions? Let me just say the following, is that if you do two-point functions, locally, again, you can still argue that this equation should satisfy if they're indeed not too close to each other. Once the operators do come close to each other, there are all kinds of funny things happening. Because indeed, what happens here is that if I start looking at a two-point function, I should consider a correlation function that on the double looks like that. This is with the second operator. And this is immediately much harder to compute. Because the intermediate channel here is not fixed. I have to sum over those intermediate channels. And the sum over those intermediate channels, indeed, if these would be primary fields in the intermediate channel, you get the usual mode decomposition of a Green's function. Another thing that's known is that if you take both of these holes, shrink them to zero size, then you just have the two-point function in the boundaries in the CFT. And that two-point function in the CFT is indeed known to be matching with the two-point function of boundary-boundary two-point function in a BTZ black hole.
You might make your life easier by taking one of the points to the boundary and leaving the other one in the
right
hole.
Of course, now comes the crux question, is that if, suppose I would do this, one of the points at the boundary, which is sort of this shrinking this point to, and then I can take the conformal dimension here and there to be just the same, and then this thing adds energy and this thing subtracts it, or the other way around, this thing could annihilate something, that thing could.
This is a bulk boundary.
This is the bulk, my propagator, and now the question is, I can write down this expression. Oh, no, not write down this. This expression is just for the three-point function, at least for the one-point function. But I could try to study this object, and I can ask, what happens if I now analytically continue that thing to Minkowski signature? And is this thing an object that actually is well-defined throughout the whole bulk space-time? And I would say I'm willing to place a bet on it. who wants to take the bet that this thing can actually be defined on the full BTZ black hole spacetime?
Including the interior.
Including the interior. Who wants to take the bet?
And full means the second side as well, the back side?
No, let's...
What does full mean?
Let's talk about that.
Well, if you're doing analytic continuation, it gets a little dicey.
Yeah, right? I'm not sure.
Yeah.
Is this thing analytic? Probably is.
Is this large C, probably.
It's a conformal block. Although in this case, it's not fully conformal block because indeed it has unspecified thing here. Indeed, which means that the bet can probably not easily be settled because this depends. This is CFT dependent. The thing I just had before is not CFT dependent because I looked at one conformal block. But in this case, I have to sum over these intermediate states. And those intermediate states, okay, well, I have to know the CFT, the spectrum of the CFT.
But is there some simple condition about the spectrum where it can be analytic?
Yeah, there's no reason to think that it's not analytic.
But could you quantify
what the condition on the spectrum is?
Yeah, okay. For example, there might be a constraint on the spectrum.
But clearly, this is the more, in the end, an interesting question to study because what it will describe is indeed, okay, well, I create some particle here, and how does it propagate into the bulk? Last minute, let me bring up one little point, sort of as a conceptual point. At some point, mathematically, there seemed to be this connection, but then physically, what does it imply? And one quickly can get confused about a bunch of things. If it's true that the bulk operator creates a hole in the boundary, that seems like a bit of a drastic operation because it means that, okay, well, if I create a point in the bulk, then I apply this operator in the bulk, there are certain parts of the boundary where it seemingly I can no longer act as an operator. And that seems like a very drastic thing to do. But let me at least give you a couple of comments about that issue of why that perhaps this hole is actually doing the thing that you might expect it to do. Let's turn around the question. Suppose I want to have a bulk field here, but now I also simultaneously want to act with an operator on the boundary. Then there are going to be positions on the boundary that if I act with the boundary operator, with the local operator here on the boundary, and I want to be able to act an operator simultaneously there, I might get into trouble if this thing actually propagates here and becomes highly boosted and essentially eliminates this region of space from the classical region of space. So it's clear that boundary operators have put restrictions on where I connect with bulk operators.
Is your hole somehow off in the complex plane, though? I mean, is it still really a hole in the Lorentzian description?
Very good question. But so the fact that there's a hole could be a reflection of this particular effect.
I think you've got away part of light. An area around the light pump, because the origin becomes a light pump.
Yeah, it's not so simple how you analytically continue from what an analytic continuation of hole means. But let me indeed relate to what Tadashi and collaborators have been doing recently as well, where they also recognize Ishibashi states as something that can represent the infrared locations of objects in the bulk. But in their proposal, they're studying essentially the use of the C-MIRA approach to try to construct the wave function on a spatial slice of AdS, whereas what I'm doing here is really just sort of in the boundary CFT. But nonetheless, I had to do this prescription of first going to Euclidean space, doing the Euclidean propagation like that, and then analytically continuing to the Minkowski signature. So personally, I would like to sort of suggest that this propagation that's here is essentially an RG flow from it's the radial evolution that goes from, this is precisely what it is, at least in this proposal, from some location in center towards something closer to the boundary. So the fact that things go first through Euclidean space, and there's a hole in Euclidean space, and then you analytically continue, I think makes it already closer to the type of ideas that Tadashi has been proposing, which indeed seems very closely related.
After the RG flow, in our case, as just a dual state to this local operator, we have just a descendant of L minus 1 plus just SL2R descendant.
Yeah, so for in our case, at least in this case, not having enough tour, at least having the full Virazoro tower involved is essential for getting this.
The black hole case, maybe.
For the black hole case, it seems that one needs the. I think I've used up my time, but we can transition into the discussion. Okay. Thank you.
Other questions or comments?
In the Ishibashi state construction, if instead of summing over SL2 descendants, you only sum over SL2 descendants, do you get back to the propagator construction?
I would say if you would do that and you go through the same thing.
No, but I just meant that the phi h itself, is phi h actually, do you actually get back to the formula that's just integrating with the boundary to bulk propagator if you only sum over it?
If here I would only do things with SL2R descendants.
Yeah. Because then you can just get a bunch of derivatives on the...
Yeah, so what that means is that the projection that I'm doing here is much more restrictive, where I don't include the full Virazoro tower, but only the descendants. I think in that case, I would exactly get this global conformal block, where indeed I project on the quasi-primary channel. And then the operator would not have these things would drop out. That would be the answer that I would get in that case.
I meant something much more basic. Because the phi h in that case is equal to integral of the k times, the time the prime.
Right. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I understand now what you're saying. So indeed, one way of making clear that what I'm doing here is different than at least the free field version of the Kabat-Lifshitz low prescription. What Kabat-Lifshitz and low do, they take a local operator, and they smear it over a boundary, and they integrate some kernel against it. But any local operator at another location is obtained by this SL2R descendants on the operator acting at a given point. So the free field Kabat-Lifshitz low operator is expressed just in terms of SL2R descendants.
Okay, so that's
so indeed the distinction between what I do here and what they do involves the higher descendants.
I just have the one comment. In Euclidean space, you don't have to make the whole round as you said. In fact, you could make it a slit on a constant imaginary time surface, and then maybe the continuation to Minkowski signature would make more sense.
Right.
Although you've sort of broken the high rotational invariance or broken
the
Hall-Lorentz invariance kind of.
So let me mention that so the question that this construction also teaches you something about what a space-time point is.
Yeah.
Because indeed I can have many operators here that could depend on arbitrarily shapes of this thing. Indeed I could turn it into a slit or anything in between. But this computation is not sense, at least is insensitive to most of the shape by virtue of the fact that this thing satisfies the Virazoro condition and that thing satisfies the Virazoro condition. So I can eliminate the shape dependence of this thing by looking at these kind of matrix elements. So the fact that this thing maps to an operator at a given point in space, so the point in space is not determined by the operator by itself, because it could actually have it's defined more generally in terms of even general shapes of this circle, but it's combinedly defined in terms of a relationship between the state and the operator. But this many to one map, the fact that there are many circles that I could choose, that many shapes of this thing that I could choose, is reminiscent also of the story of this ambiguity that people talk about in the context of the Kabat-Lifshitz low construction, that indeed there may be many boundary representations of the same bulk operator, and that can be used potentially to prove bulk locality, at least to prove something that's approximate bulk locality, because if you use the locality of the Euclidean CFT, you may be able to and it proves certain properties of these operators commuting with local boundary operators when they are space-like subway. So that's indeed an open question.
How do you prove that this thing
commutes with space-like subway?
Do you have a proposal for not just a point but a world line in terms of these states, a propagating world line?
Yeah, so for a long time I thought that the relationship between bulk and boundary could be more easily studied indeed by indeed identifying bulk states with conformal blocks of the CFT in a similar way as that Trans-Simons theory, the Hilbert space of Trans-Simons theory, is the conformal blocks of the WCW model. I thought that in some moral sense, the Hilbert space of 2 plus 1 gravity is the space of conformal blocks of the CFT. But then if you have a vertex operator sitting somewhere, it sort of naturally already defines a world line in that case, because the conformal blocks satisfy a conformal word identity, which you can identify with the Wheeler-DeWitt equation in the bulk, and then that automatically creates that line. But here, the goal is different, where you start off with a state that doesn't have a particle, and then this local operator just creates the particle at that point. So then the world line would either be in the future of it or in the past of it. So this is the end point of the world line. So what you're asking is a rather different question than the one that I'm looking at.
Is your construction then consistent with that Wheeler-DeWitt way of thinking?
Good question.
Yeah, but related to that, you know, I mean, because of my ignorance, you know, if you have this kind of geography in mind, right, then, you know, what we said just before would correspond to this, the point that, you know, the dynamics is CFT, two dynamics, right, and everything else is kind of kinematical in a sense, right? There is no new dynamics due to radial coordinate.
At least the CFT prescribes the dynamics in the bulk, at least if once you would know the dynamics.
Right, so there's no new dynamics due to this.
But that's actually a very old argument of why holography would work.
Right, but when you are doing this, it looks like, I don't know, you are talking about somewhat dynamics which is in the bulk, right, instead of...
Right. So that's obviously the direction that one would want to start thinking about, at least. What does it now mean to take two operators and what happens?
So in this way, it's not completely holographical, right, in this sense. Because you are saying that there is something which is sitting right there.
Right. Now, it seems obviously the idea is to try to move away from the boundary. Mm-hmm.
So it has been an important thing in your construction to include all Virasoro descendants, right?
Yep.
So what would be the generalization to higher dimensions then?
I don't know.
It's for the afternoon discussion.
It's for the afternoon discussion. Yeah, at least. The thing is that it seems that if one does the higher dimension, the naive higher dimensional analog, that would correspond to doing what was just mentioned, is that if this were not made out of all the Virasoro descendants, but only of the, indeed, of the primary descendants, of the global descendants, you don't get the correspondence we get here. So in some ways, the back reaction in the bulk doesn't appear. They take place if you only have the
bulk. The relative normalizations between different matrix elements with different H1, H2, and H3, H4, is that completely prescribed by your definition?
Yeah, because of the limit. So I don't need to worry about the overall normalization of the operator, because I fixed that the limit when y goes to 0, that the operator matches with the local operator on the boundary. So once I have the wave equation, I don't need to worry about numerical coefficients.
Okay, so the numerical coefficients as a function of H1, H2, H3, H4, that's completely fixed?
That's completely fixed because, indeed, I know that I'm matching it to what happens at the boundary.
Okay.
I'm
sorry, isn't it the three quotient coefficients that's not fixed?
Well,
In this case, because of the... Once I know that this thing matches with the local operator of the CFT, then the bulk dependence.
Yeah, but this overall coefficient, that's the triple function.
Right. No, right. So indeed, there is some coefficient here, but that coefficient is exactly the right one to give me the correspondence that I need.
But it's completely fixed once and for all by one of these matrix elements.
Yeah, but the overall normalization here may indeed be CFT dependent. This is CFT, but it's CFT dependent in such a way that this thing indeed matches with the corresponding CFT.
Okay. Now, can I ask one more question, which is, where in any of this did you use the fact that there was a big gap in the spectrum?
So I'm using here in the large C in order to at
large
least...
Large C is not a big gap.
I understand. It's not a big gap.
But there's some story about the identity block dominating, at least in the other work you mentioned, which requires the gap.
Right. Now, so for example, well, if they're light fields, other light fields in the bulk, and there might be a drag. But basically, I'm making use of the fact that all the interactions that take place in the bulk indeed are suppressed by 1 over over C. But in order to really test whether the bulk is a local theory, I should start looking at two-point functions, and I should ask when does a two-point function start deviating substantially from a field-theoretic two-point function. And that depends on the intermediate channels here. And then the issue of having a gap may be important.
Or higher-point function.
So if this is some ugly bulk theory that does all kinds of funny things, then that should show up in the...
Even W also grounds for the higher spin theories. How do you exclude those?
Again, if I define this thing in terms of the Virasoro Ishibashi state, I don't care at this point about, at this level, about currents, other currents in the story. But they will show up in the behavior of the two-point function, indeed, because of the intermediate states.
I mean, everything you've done, it seems to me, Alex talked the other day about, you know, doing these symmetric product orbifolds with large C,
right,
which generically don't look like they have local bulk physics. But all of this would work for all of us.
So one more question here. I didn't parse the details of your hypergeometric vector function. Does your conformal block have a branch cut in it, or is it really a well-defined single-valued function?
Right. Actually, in my paper, I may have done a slight typo there. There's a 4 here, and I think there's a 4 here. Yeah. And that 4 was bothering me for a while, and I can tell you how this thing comes about. The point is that this thing is the absolute value squared of a left mover times a right mover. And if I take the square of a hypergeometric function, that's actually a factor of I here, and the absolute value squared of this thing, then the second hypergeometric function has a minus sign sitting here, and then I use some identity of hypergeometric function that spits out that factor.
So the formula, the correct
so the thing with this factor
is single value.
Follows from this, and it's single value. Right. But it does have a branch cut, obviously. It does have a...
It
does have a branch cut.
It does have a branch cut.
Yeah, it does have a branch cut.
Okay, so does it really satisfy that equation motion exactly, or is there a source at the branch point?
The thing is that the it analytically... anyway, we can talk more about this point, rho equals 1, if you want. But that's obviously
that's
where
the
interesting
that's
point.
The horizon, right?
So that's the interesting point. But if I would do the normal thing that one would do by solving wave equations in the bulk, I think that's the appropriate thing to do in this context as well. But
I'll ask you in a second.
Do you see a way to relate this operator to the operator you would get using the Kvantlewicz's prescription?
Of how to make the link between this and that? At large C, I find the same. You could say, well, mine operator corresponds to theirs, although I didn't use any notion of a bulk in my definition, so I'm reproducing what they have. However, maybe you want to comment on this. Indeed, Kvantlewicz now has a more elaborate version where you include all the interactions. Even that interacting version of Kabat-Lifshitz's law makes use of presumed knowledge of a bulk theory. But then the claim would be that this prescription would have to match with what one gets by doing the full
but just
exact
just
bulk
just
reconstruction.
To lowest order, is it clear that this operator that creates a hole is equal to this new ring of local operators.
The test that I've done is indeed what I just did, namely that the bulk equation motion is.
I think it's different because a smeared local operator means that the smearing translating means you've acted only with the SL2C L1 and L-1.
That's right.
Not the full set of your origin.
Right.
So these operators that are built out of Vera Sorogen descendant seem like there's something really different. And actually, maybe you said this, but a Vera Sorogen descendant, what is the bulk interpretation? It's exciting a boundary graviton?
Yeah, that's one way of thinking about it.
Because you have all of these low-lying operators that are not.
Right.
So something really, I don't know, I think it seems like it's something superficially different.
It's different from what they do, and it even includes all kinds of directions. The way I think about this is an intuitive picture. This thing has a remarkable, I would call it, a self-focusing property. It's an object that I put on the boundary, and it emits rays into the bulk. But then, independent of what kind of state I put it between, at least certainly for these kind of highly excited states, it finds a focal point in the bulk. Because that's the location at which it acts. So the fact that this is a local operator is a rather funny focusing property that it finds a local point in the bulk that actually depends on the state that it put there.
So the statement that it is not the same as HKLL means it does not reduce to their formula in any limit?
No, this is why I was saying that. I was not saying it's completely different. It's different because it involves the higher descendants. But indeed, in the large C limit, it satisfies the same equation. And once you have the same wave equation and you have the same boundary condition, then in some limit, it becomes the same.
You said the descendants aren't important in large C.
But the free field Bachelet's law prescription is one that every time, which is it's nonlinear. Because it depends on that state. I have to know the state, and then I can free field propagate.
It's clear that their prescription must be an approximation because they're using indeed something from the bulk. They reconstruct it, go back to the boundary, you do the smearing there, but you do a lot of non-local things that are not clear what they mean in the CFT. Because you use some knowledge about what the CFT looks like, and that's only semi-classical limit of this expression. So it's only an approximation. To a better, I think this is a more exact answer because this is true.
Well, no, but HKLL, there's a consistent story for extending it to higher orders in 1 over C. It's not just that formula. That formula is like the sort of zeroth order piece.
But that story, even the extension in 1 over C, in my opinion, has not been formulated in an intrinsic way. I don't think if I give you a CFT,
I think it is well defined. And
but then it should.
So if this is correct, it should agree. I mean, these 1 over C corrections should just reproduce those 1 over C corrections.
One question you could ask is that actually these guys have an exact expression that actually works for finite C. It requires a particular interpretation of what their argument in their function is, which actually has to do with this quantum group. But it's interesting to speculate that this thing contains some physics in the bulk, where the 1 over C corrections in this expression are actually related to,
Does that thing know about, like, the matter fields or something, right? Because the 1 over N correction certainly
knows. By definition, in some ways, by construction, this thing is a conformal bulk that doesn't care about anything else in the CFT. It's just one single conformal bulk.
But then it can't be right at higher orders than 1 over N, right?
That's the one-point function in a CFT. At least does this depend on other things.
If you look at higher point functions, it's null, right? And this is supposed to be an operator equation, so.
Correct. But this thing will know about other higher point function. Of this thing knows about other states in the CFT because of the fact that we start summing those channels. So higher point functions are CFT specific.
Okay. Let's thank Herman again.